Hey nerds, what's up? Today I'm going to talk about Project Hail Mary by Andy Weir. I have mixed feelings about it. On the one hand, I absolutely loved it. But on the other hand, there was like some things I felt were kind of weird and unsuccessful about it, leaving me confused. So I want to talk about it today. See you after the jump. Okay, so I read The Martian back in 2020, which I thought I read it several years ago. I guess 2020 just lasted an eternity, but it was one of my top 8 books that I read in 2020. I absolutely loved The Martian, everything about it. I read it in like 2 days. So I was super excited because everyone was going crazy about Project Hail Mary. I had actually skipped Artemis because I heard very mixed reviews, and some of the negative reviews I heard, I kind of knew that book probably wouldn't be good for me. But when I heard everyone like going head over heels for Project Hail Mary, I knew I had to read it. I thought I was going to be blown away again. And in some ways I was. So I'm gonna start there. I'm gonna start with what I love and the positives. I should mention this is actually gonna be a full spoiler review because I can't talk about what I like and dislike about it without spoiling this book. I will say I went into this book completely blind like I normally try to do, and I do think it really helps. So in my opinion, you should go in as blind as possible. So turn off now. So Weir knows how to do the loner in space. Like, he's just good at it. The Martian was that, this is sort of that, and he just got back to what he knew. I care deeply about what's happening. Like, he gets me there. He gets me caring about the mission, caring about what's going on, caring about his characters. He's also very good at making me feel the anxiety, something that he did very well in The Martian as well. Like, I felt it. I felt the anxiousness. And even though I wouldn't say he's like some like grand prose master, some way how the way he describes space really impresses that like lonely, scary, vast feeling. Like, I don't know how he does it, but he really gets like the heart of that feeling. Who couldn't love Rocky? Rocky's incredible. I loved him so much. I love the whole alien race. I loved the differences. I loved how they had to work together. Like, that whole thing was just totally up my alley, them building a friendship and the way they were similar and different. Like, I just thought it was done very, very well. And I mean, I loved it. It was a very emotional thing to find out that they were two different races from completely different planets, and they both come here for the same reason, to save their planets. They're both the only ones left of everyone on the mission, and it's just up to them. I don't care if that's like convenient or whatever. It's such a good story. Like, oh, you just can't help but root for that. Like, it just feels so big that you just, you know, it's like a classic, kind of gets to the heart of humanity, right? Going to save humanity. Like, those stories are as old as time, and I don't care. I love them, and I love the way it makes me feel. There were also some moments that genuinely surprised me, like when you find out that Grace didn't even actually want to go on the mission. Like, I actually was extremely surprised by that. I did not expect it. I also loved when you found out that Talmoba was resistant to Xenite, and like they're far away and that discovery is made. Like, whew, that was so good. Like, the anxiety of finding the Talmoba in the fuel, like, he really just gets you there. Like, I felt it. So me saying this, you're gonna be like, what was there not to like? Like, I did the plot and so much of it I just loved. But there were some things that made me just struggle with this book a little bit. Let's talk about them. The first thing is the tone of the main character. I actually really struggled with the first 50 pages because of the tone of the main character. Grace comes off very cheesy in the beginning, and it's particularly in the dialogue. There was so much dialogue that I sat there and I was like, this doesn't sound like real people would say this. This isn't how people would talk. And my book is really high up and I didn't mark the example. I'll put it on screen. The example that I was thinking of is just, and this was mostly a problem in flashbacks, I realized. Like, just a lot of the dialogue I struggled with, it felt cheesy. I find that the dialogue worked much more naturally with Rocky. So again, like I said, it was mostly kind of in the flashbacks that it really mattered and kind of made me feel corny. I feel like he actually kind of ended up writing the same character in a way that he wrote in The Martian. The problem is that it worked very well in The Martian. I think one of the reasons is that there was a lot less dialogue in The Martian. It was mostly internal dialogue. And I felt that Grace was pretty good in the internal dialogue, but it was like too similar to The Martian almost. Like, I wanted a different character. And I wonder if it's just that Weir is very comfortable with that type of character. Cause really, Grace was basically whoever the main character was in The Martian, I can't remember, but didn't swear. That was like the only difference. So from what I've heard about Artemis, he really went with a different character, and it was a lot of people criticized it. So I don't know if this is true, but I wonder if he was like, okay, I'm going to go back to what I know I can write. And I know I can write this, so I'm just going to do it. The problem is that the stakes are about 1,000 times higher in Project Hail Mary than in The Martian. Now, of course, when you're reading The Martian, it feels extremely high stakes. You've got this guy stuck on Mars, you know? But compared to Project Hail Mary, which is literally saving all of humanity, the stakes can't be compared. And so because of that, I found that Project Hail Mary actually brought up some very interesting moral questions, particularly in the flashbacks, about basically someone giving all power to just get this done. And, you know, what was the morality of that? Like, I think of the melting ice scene. Like, that was a very intense scene. And there was a lot of scenes like that that really made me question. But he threw jokes in and made light of it so often that you were never allowed to just, like, marinate in that moral question. And there was so many dilemmas presented throughout the novel, but because it was always like the next thing was the butt of a joke, I didn't get enough time to really like ruminate on that. And look, I'm not asking Weir to be like Becky Chambers and to be taught or Fortunate or to be like Ted Chiang. Like, I'm not asking him to like make this super serious book or character, but I do think Grace being slightly more serious would have really benefited this novel. Or another alternative would have been that Grace was front-facing, very jokey like that, but internally at least was a little bit more serious and it was just like a front. I think just like that slight tweak would have made a lot of the flashback scenes a little bit more successful for me and taken a lot of the cheese out. Number two, why was Grace allowed to be in every single meeting? This annoyed me through the entire book. Why was this random science teacher allowed into all the meetings? Like, at first it made sense, because here's the thing. When I'm reading a book like this, I am willing to suspend disbelief. Like, I want to. I want to be there with the author. Like, I am not trying to be hard on it. I'm kind of one of those people that is willing to go along for the ride for the most part. So when they ask him because he's done this like stupid no water life thing, like, I loved that. I was so on board for them getting him there. I was even on board for him like running back in and demanding he gets to do it. Like, I'm on board for that. I don't care if it's unrealistic, like, I'm on board. But after that, he's in every meeting and he's like acting like her second. And Weir tries to explain it away by having people question it, but it just never made sense to me why he was so trained. And I get that when he finally was chosen, the main lady was like, I've been training you this whole time to be the third. But I was like, why though? You weren't seemingly training anyone else next to you to be the third for the other two? So that detail just like really got on my nerves and I couldn't ignore it. I felt like there could have been a better explanation. Like, maybe they died earlier or something and he was the only one who knew enough. I don't know. I mean, the thing is though, then it would ruin that cool reveal that he didn't want to go, which I did love. So I don't know. Maybe that's just one we have to live with. And finally, three, the memory loss was kind of weird. Like, who gets memory loss like that and then just remembers things linearly? Like, that's not how it works, right? When other things have triggered it. Like, so that was like a little hard to believe. I will be honest, of all the criticisms, this one's the one I'm easiest to let go, because again, I want this to work. And it obviously provided some pretty intense moments when he didn't remember anything. It was also a very convenient way to not just info dump on us. So this one I'm willing to let go, but it was something I noticed for someone who prides himself on being very realistic science-wise, and Project Hail Mary in terms of like the space stuff and the science surrounding the new organisms was so realistic and dead on and like so interesting and just full of jargon. It feels weird that kind of like the brain science of remembering was so off. I think that's why it's more in contrast in this book, because usually he's very good at science. So overall, number one was the most challenging for me. I just really struggled with Grace's characterization and his tone. It really hurt the novel for me. I just wish that Weir would have pushed himself and did something slightly different. That being said, even though that was a big deal to me, I still ended up giving Project Hail Mary a 4 because, oh gosh, I love everything else about it. I love the alien race, I love Rocky, I love the ending, I love how everything's resolved. I just really wish that had been changed. So I'm gonna be really interested to see what happens with Andy Weir going forward with his next book. I'm really hoping he'll challenge himself and make a different kind of character. Not that I want his books to not be humorous. Again, I think he is pretty funny, and so I think humorous books are great for him, but I think you can still have a humorous book and not have every character be that same cookie cutter. See, First Law, right? First Law is actually hilarious. No character in that is cheesy or like over the top silly or jokey. So I hope that's kind of maybe the next direction, because I do just love the way Weir writes space. Overall, The Martian is just the tighter book to me. everything about The Martian felt tight. I really had zero complaints about it, whereas I have this big one for Project Hail Mary. But I'd like to know what you think, because I feel like this is very unpopular, because everyone I know has been giving like Project Hail Mary 5 stars, and that's their top book of the year. So I'm curious if any of these criticisms ring true, but you just didn't care about them, or maybe now you'll notice them, or if you totally disagree. I'm just really curious to hear what you think. Let me know in the comments below. And as always, if you like these kind of videos, please like and subscribe. And if you want to chat with me or see what I'm currently reading, the best way to do that is on Instagram at bookborn.reviews. I'll see you next time. Bye.